metamaterials, so soft metamaterials like bubble and foam. And today, Juliette is going to talk about surprising acoustic propagation in foams from liquid to solid. Dr. Pierre,
Thank you. Okay, so good afternoon, everyone. I currently work at Danover Institute in Paris, and this work started 10 years ago with my first postdoctoral position at Laboratory Material System Complex, also in Paris. And after 10 years, a lot of people have been involved in this presentation. So Valentin Leroy, Caroline Derek, and Florence Elias, researchers at Material System Complex Lab. Camille Gollon was a PhD student with us until 2018. Benjamin Delay, currently in Grenoble, but previously in Rennes. Arnaud Saint-James, researcher in Rennes. Vulpodan Khan, previously in Orsay and now at Institut Charles Sadron in Strasbourg. And finally, Luc Jaouan, Fabien Chevisiot, and François-Xavier Becot from Matelis Research Lab. So, what first? Why liquid foams? Because it's beautiful, because it can be useful in our daily life for firefighter or for your shower. Also because it can be useful for the animal life. For example, these small frogs used foam to protect their eggs. And so finally, because it's everywhere around us. So basically, what is a liquid foam? It is a mixture of gas and liquid with surfactant to stabilize the structure. So one goes from a bubbly liquid to a liquid foam when bubbles are close to the close compact condition. And in liquid foams, bubbles are not spherical at home. And as you can see on this picture, bubbles are closed by thin film, colored here, and attached on to liquid channel, here in white. And it is important to note that the most important part of the liquid is contained inside the liquid channel. So liquid foams are out of equilibrium systems, and they evolve continuously during time by coarsening, by bubble coalescence, and obviously, thanks to the gravity drainage. So now, what about liquid foams acoustics? You already experienced the ability of liquid foams to block sound. For example, if you are in your foaming bath, if you put some foam on your ear, you cannot hear a word. And in a more noisy way, since the 70s, for the military application, liquid foams has been considered to confine explosions. And I want to show you a short video realized in 1985 by the US Army in the desert. So they explore the possibility to confine pollution and particles ejected during the explosion. So the video.
We discovered soapy foams to neutralize chemical and biological threats like anthrax.
The chemistry is not that complicated. It's similar to a combination of hair conditioner and toothpaste.
Four, three.
And where a terrorist dirty bomb.
One.
Might spread biological agents endangering populations. They found that foam and a tent could smother the blast.
This would trap the biological, chemical, or radiological.
Okay. So from that, we find only few works. It is a very interesting application, but we find only few work on the topic trying to understand the physical mechanism underlying this observation. But to use liquid foam for insulation, to have a good insulation, we must understand acoustic propagation very well. So we start the adventure 10 years ago with a fundamental point of view. And in the same times, in French also, two PhD theses were supported by two French military organizations, but specifically concerned with mitigation of shock and blast waves. So the PhD of Emily Del Prete and Martha Monlou, both in Britain. I don't know why. For example, in this beautiful work, Martin Monlou, during his PhD students, explored the ability to shaving foam to dissipate shock waves. Here, an explosive in can see an explosion inside a shaving foam. So first, the energy is dissipated by bubble breaking, and after by dissipation inside the foam. So how does acoustic wave propagate in such complex structure? So in this presentation, I would like to address these two fundamental questions. How does a liquid foam move when unsonified? And how does an acoustic wave dissipate? First, what happens in a bubbly liquid when the bubbles are dispersed in the liquid phase? In a bubbly liquid, thanks to the large compressibility of the gas and the strong density of the liquid, bubbles strongly resonate at a very low frequency. And that means that even if the wavelength is 500 bigger than the bubble size, the acoustic waves feel the presence of the bubble. So one consequence of this resonance is a strong dispersion in frequency. As you can see on this graph, the attenuation as a function of the frequency, and here a huge maximum. This maximum is the signature of the monopolar resonance of the bubble, so-called the Minard resonance. So as I said before, one goes from a bubbly liquid to a liquid foam, compacting the bubbles. In a foam, bubbles are arranged above the ground compact condition, and so bubbles are not spherical anymore. And they are delimited by thin film attached on the liquid channel, which draw an interconnected liquid matrix. And this last point is crucial, because in such condition, bubbles cannot exhibit a monopolar resonance. They cannot pulse. So how does sound propagate in liquid foams? So we build different experimental setup to explore a large frequency range and a large number of foam with different bubble distribution, different liquid, different gas nature, and in different proportion. And basically, the foams are elaborating using a very simple technique. We use two syringes, one with a desired volume of gas, the other with a desired volume of soaking solution. We connect the syringe together, and we push the mixture from one side to the other. And so the mixture is shared inside the junction area, creating the bubble. So with this technique, we precisely know the liquid fraction contained in the foam. We also measure the bubble size distribution using the bubble raft technique. So we perch a small amount of the foam on the soaking solution. The bubbles spontaneously dispersed on the liquid soaking solution, and we can photograph and analyze easily the bubble size contained inside the foam. So we have access to the bubble size, the median bubble size R, and the polydispersity epsilon. We call epsilon. So the polydispersity is how much the bubbles are different. And finally, foams evolve over time. So we measure the bubble size distribution in time. And it has been, we know that this distribution evolves as the square root of the time. So let's go to the experimental setup. We wanted to probe a large frequency range and be able to monitor the acoustic properties over time. To do so, we built two main experiments, one in the audible regime and the second one in the ultrasonic regime. And It is important to note that we work always with a large acoustic wavelength compared with the bubble size. So the first experiment here is based on an impedance tube vertically placed because foam flow, and a loudspeaker here emits a plane waves between 0.6 and 6 kilohertz, and using the reflected signal recorded by two microphones, we are able to determine in real time the sound velocity, here the density, and the attenuation as a function of the frequency. And as the emission and the reception are faster than the ripening time of the phone, we can probe the acoustic parameter over time. At higher frequency, we build another setup. The acoustic propagation in the foam has been measured using a transmission setup. We send a broadband acoustic pulse between 60 and 600 kHz. The acoustic wave is propagating through a cell containing the foam with very, very thin film, around something like 1 or 3 microns. And we record the complex transmission as a function of the frequency. From this transmitted signal, we can determine the complex wave number of our liquid foam. And as this operation is faster than the rippling of the foam, repeating the transmission analysis over time, we are able to measure the complex wave number as a function of the frequency and the time. So now, this is what we get with this experimental setup. I represent here the complex wave number as a function of the frequency for a foam evolving in time. So we use a soaping solution, a simple foam with a soaping solution with no bulk and no surface viscoelasticity. And note also that we add in the air, in the gaseous phase, perfluorohexane. The first effect is to slow down the coarsening of the foam. And the second important effect is to increase the gas density and thus the decrease the sound velocity in the gaseous phase. So the sound velocity goes from 340 meter by second in the air to 260 meter by second in the gas mixture. So, and finally, we choose a liquid fraction around 10%. So a lot of gas. Okay, so on this graph, colored code for the median radius increasing over time, red for the smaller, blue for the larger. A colored cycle represents the real part of the wave number, and the white square is an imaginary part. And clearly, the acoustic propagation we measure strongly depends on the acoustic frequency and the bubble size. But this dispersion is not random at all. Indeed, all curves associated with a various bubble size can rescale with the bubble size at the power 3/2. And so what we observe on these two master curves, here the real part and here the imaginary part, we observe first two non-dispersive regimes. One at low frequency, with a defined by a velocity around 30 meters by second, and another one where the velocity is close to the one of the gas mixture. And in between these two non-dispersive regimes, there is a very interesting one where the attenuation becomes large and reach a maximum. Okay, so this kind of curves are typical of a resonant behavior. In bubbly liquid, the acoustic propagation is very similar. But as I said before, we cannot expect a monopolar resonance if bubbles are connected. So what are the physical mechanisms behind this? The wave number is the combination between the compressibility and the density. And so the compressibility expresses the ability of the system to change volume. So in liquid form, there is more air than liquid. So we can easily assume that no change of volume can occur. At the contrary, to what happens in a bubbly liquid. So we can assume that the effective compressibility in liquid forms doesn't depend on the frequency and only depends on the quantity of liquid and gas. So it results from a mixture law between the gas property in proportion and the liquid property in proportion. So in this case, the liquid properties are negligible in comparison with the gas. For the effective density, it is more complicated. And the effective density is something like the inertia felt by the acoustic waves. And as you can see on this graph, the effective density strongly depends on the frequency. And so here it is the imaginary part, and here the real part. And here there is some negative value. So how can we explain these curves? Liquid forms are very complex. So they are composed with thin films, elastic films, and AV networks, liquid networks, containing the most important part of the liquid. And so liquid films and liquid channel are both very, very different inertia. So we build a toy model by looking the foam as a stack of circular liquid films attached on a liquid ring. So the film attached on a liquid ring here, as you can see here, and plane waves propagate through the stack, leading to the displacement of the ring and the film. Okay, so I have no time to develop all steps of the calculation, but briefly, first, we calculated the displacement of a single element, ring films. One important element is the restoring force applied at the film ring junction here, because it takes into account for phenomenological damping time. And I will come back on this parameter later, but it is very important for the attenuation process. And one other parameter, important parameter, is the capillary wave number of the film. And because even if the pressure field is uniform in the lateral direction, it produces oscillation of the film because the film is attached on the ring. And it's attached on the ring. So then, as the wavelength of the acoustic wavelength is larger than the bubble size, we can assume that the gas inside a unit cell can move in block. And finally, we can calculate the average displacement of a unit cell and related it to an effective density. So this is the final expression of the effective density. It is beautiful. We have the liquid fraction of the liquid channel, the liquid fraction of the film. An important parameter is the fraction of surface covered by the film. And here we have the phenomenological damping, which drastically changes the imaginary part of the effective density. And the very important part, a very important expression, is this function HQH depending of the capillary wavelengths. This function is very, very important because it describes the coupling between the film and the meniscus. And from this function, we can have three different regimes. When QA goes in zero, HQA goes in one. When QA goes at the infinity, HQA goes in zero. And when the Bessel function, the fundamental Bessel function goes in zero, in this case, this function diverge. So if we compare this this model with our experiments, the plane and the dashed line represent the toy model. We need five parameters to compute this model. Three are known. Here, the median radius, the median radius R0, we used to normalize our data, the liquid fraction and the surface tension. And two parameters are adjustable, the film thickness and the damping parameter. So as you can see, the model catches very well our experimental data. And at low, what happens in the different regime? At low frequency, we have a first regime of propagation. So the animation show you here, but very amplified, okay? The displacement of the liquid channel and the film. And in this regime, the whole liquid phase moves in phase with the acoustic wave propagated through the foam. And the effective density felt by the acoustic waves results from a mixture law between liquid and gas. And in this case, the gas density is negligible in comparison with the liquid one. So the effective density is just the liquid fraction times the liquid density. And to confirm that, I want to show you what happened for the sound velocity at very low frequency in the audible regime. So this measure has been recording using the impedance tube experiment I presented to you before. So on this graph, you can see the velocity as a function of the liquid fraction at 1 kHz for different, for various type of foam. And all the data are in according with a simple mixture law, a so-called Wood's law. So the velocity is just resulting from this, this mixture law. And at the end, it only depends on the liquid fraction. Kappa is the polytropic exponent, P0 is the atmospheric pressure, and L is the density of the liquid. So there is, in reality, there is one exception, the shining foam. I don't know why we try to reproduce the chemistry with controlling foam, but without success. So for all shaving foam we try, the velocity is higher than Wood's law. It's here. But for the other, it's worked very well. So let's go back to how effective density over the frequency. At high frequency, we have the second non-dispersive regime, and in this case, only the film moves and the density is very low and close to the gas density. So finally, in between these two extreme regimes, there is a very interesting regime of propagation where film moves in opposition phase with the liquid channel and the acoustic waves. So the acoustic propagation of our foams, liquid foams, exhibit a dipolar resonance, leading to a negative effective density and a large attenuation. It is important to note that We don't need a regular organization of the bubble. We don't need a monopolar organization, monopolar bubbles to observe this behavior. With something isotropic and polydispersed, we obtain this kind of acoustic behavior. So note also that close to the resonance, the propagation is not really evanescent. The attenuation is very important, but doesn't diverge. And this is due to the restoring force between the film and the meniscus. So increasing the gas fraction, one goes continuously from a bubbly liquid to a liquid foam. But even if both are like soft acoustic metamaterials, their acoustic properties are remarkably different, completely different. Bubbly liquid present a monopolar resonance leading to a negative effective compressibility. So in other words, when you compress the medium, the microstructure reacts, increasing its volume. And liquid foams present a dipolar resonance leading to a negative effective density. So when you push the medium, the microstructure responds with an acceleration in the opposite way. As we've seen before, the acoustic properties of this attenuation strongly depends on the bubble size and the frequency. The toy model that I previously exposed catches very well the experimental data, and this using a purely ad hoc dissipation parameters, the viscous time, the viscous damping time, and it theoretically accounts for the viscous friction between the thin film and the AV liquid networks, but we don't know the physical mechanism behind this damping parameter. It is not clear at all. So let's go back to the literature and what other people say about the dissipation inside liquid foams. So these first two works are very nice, and the authors explore with experimental measurements the origin of the dissipation, and they consider only thermal losses, but using a scaling law approach. But this is very questionable because in this older work, authors make experiments with air and helium foams. And the thermal diffusion of the thermal coefficient of helium is 70 times higher than the air one. So they expect an attenuation in helium foam 70 times lower than the one in air foam. But the measurement give them two attenuation coefficients quite comparable, as you can see here. So they conclude that the thermal loss cannot explain everything. And some years later, the same author tried to explain the observation by adding a viscous loss caused by the liquid flow inside the liquid network. But the two previous papers explore this, and this model doesn't work with their experimental measurement. So can we go further with our setup and with control foam? First, the thermal loss. So in this part of the seminar, let us focus on propagation at low frequency before the resonance and where the velocity is non-dispersive, doesn't depend on the frequency. So we can look only at the attenuation. So first, the thermal loss. In this expression of the thermal attenuation, a dimension by the velocity and the acoustic pulsation, as you can see, it depends only on the polytropic exponent coefficient. Sorry, the polytropic coefficient. And in this frequency range, at low frequency, in the audible regime, the real part is equal to one, and the imaginary part depends on the on the bubble size, on the frequency, the acoustic frequency, and the thermal diffusivity, So inspired by the previous work, we selected four foams with the same soaking solution, the same liquid fraction, the same bubble size, and but for four different gases: air, perfluoroxane, a mixture between air and perfluoroxane, and helium foam. And in this case, we considering the gas property, we expect that helium foam attenuation will be 7 times less than air foam. Here I plot the expected results for the adimension thermal attenuation, the theoretical thermal attenuation. And as you can see, helium foam is predicted to be lower than the air one. But here, what I get experimentally, so clearly helium foam dissipate more than air foam. Okay. But and also for all foams, the attenuation level is larger than the predicted one. So at this stage, we can conclude that at low frequency, thermal loss doesn't explain on its own the dissipation process. So what are the other dissipation sources? Here, in this area, there is a strange decrease in, and in reality, it's not so strange. It is due to the dissipation close to the wall of the tube, of the impedance tube. It is so due to the dissipation by friction on the wall. And in this area, the foam is shared, and so the sound is dissipated. And larger the tube, the smaller the dissipation. So this source of dissipation is not intrinsic to the foam. So I won't develop it there, here. Sorry. And what next? So we can remove the contribution of the thermal attenuation and the wall dissipation. And you can see what remains. As you can see, we get something which increases linearly with the frequency. And this expression here traduces the viscous loss and linearly depends on the frequency. But considering a viscosity here, and this viscosity, it is important to note that it is not an effective viscosity of the foam. Okay, this viscosity occurs at the bubble scale. So our vision is that when the acoustic wave propagates through the foam, bubble slightly oscillate and generate a non-negligible viscous dissipation close to the bubble wall, so close to the thin subfilm. And so now we can use this expression to fit our experimental data and extract this viscosity parameter called eta bub to try to understand the origin of this, clearly the physical mechanism behind this this parameter. So it is found to slightly increase with the liquid fraction. So we can conclude that this source of dissipation is not compatible at all with the mechanism of Darcy flow proposed by Goldfarb et al. Here it is the prediction of Goldfarb and our data. So we don't know why, but we know that this dissipation doesn't come from a flow inside the liquid network. And more interestingly, if we look now how it depends on the gas density, it is very interesting because it decreases with the gas density. Okay. And so if I can conclude on this acoustic propagation in liquid foam with this 4 points. The network of the liquid channeled hold by the thin film liquid, the thin liquid films allow for a strong coupling between the air and the liquid motions and give rise a negative density around the resonance. Around the resonance, the sound is fully blocked, not fully, but very attenuated. And even before the resonance, the sound dissipation is very important due to the thin liquid film. So the bubble size and the gas property can drastically change the ability of foam to trap acoustic energy. So we don't know precisely what happens for the dissipation close to the film, the thin film, but we know that it happens in this area. So liquid foams are very interesting, but they flow and they are ephemeral. So for soundproofing application, for industrial application, they are clearly not ideal. So from that, from the result of about liquid foams, can we find or build solid materials? With similar acoustic properties. So soundproofing material used for industrial application are mostly the same with open porosity, and the air cells are fully interconnected. As for mineral wool, porous concrete or foam, typically, for example, in an anechoic chamber, they use foams with open pores. And why? Because in this material, the acoustic attenuation occurs through visco-inertial and thermal dissipative effects along the open pores. And in this case, pores have to be open because like that the wave can enter inside the material, and smaller enough to allow for large motion of air. So inspired by liquid foams, we look at solid foams where the pores are closed by very thin membrane. Okay, but the membrane are not like in the foam elastic, they are wavy, a little bit wavy, as you can see here. But this is a solid foam. And we look at the effect of this membrane on the acoustic propagation. So in this experiment, we work with similar foam, but one has open pores and the other one are closed by very thin membrane around 1 micron thickness. So the experiment was all realized in the audible regime using the previous impedance tube setup. And here I show you the absorption coefficient. Why is the absorption coefficient? Because it is the coefficient used for the characterization of porous materials. Classically, so as a function of the frequency, and in both cases, so this is two different foam with different pore size, and in both cases, the foam where cells are closed by thin membranes leads to a better absorption. So this result is very interesting because the popular opinion is that the pore have to be small and open. In this case, the pores are large, 3 millimeters. It's large for solid foam, and closed by a lot of pores are closed by thin film. So, how can we explain that? I think the absorption coefficient is not the good parameter to look at because it depends on the thickness of the samples. So, what does the acoustic density and compressibility tell us? So, this is here. So, the these results are for the larger pores. And here you have the complex bulk modulus. The bulk modulus is just the inverse of the compressibility. And as you can see, for open and closed foam, the bulk modulus or the compressibility are close to the compressibility, the air compressibility. But as for the liquid foam, the density is affected by the membrane. So for open foam, the density is comparable to the air one, but when the pore cells are closed by thin membrane, the real part and the imaginary part of the effective density becomes higher. And if we look now at one fixed frequency, so we are around 3 kHz, for different pore size with the same for different pore size, we can look that when pores are open, they are always close to the density, the air density, but the presence of membrane increase the density, the real part and the imaginary part. But there is no clear trend in terms of pore size, so it is still an open question. And before conclude, I want to show you this last experiment. If I plunge an open cell foam in a soapy solution, now the pores, the cells, become closed by soap film. And if we compare the real part of the density as a function of the frequency for the open foam, the foam closed with solid membrane and the foam with soap film, it is very interesting to see that for the foam with the soapy film, we have a negative density. So now imagine that the membrane of our solid foams are elastic as the soap film and not wavy. We could have a new type of metamaterials. So to summarize with this acoustic propagation in solid membrane foams, membranes are deformable and thin, and sound can propagate through the foam and lost a lot of energy because of the large surface area it can interact with. So solid membrane foam could be valuable new sound absorber. As for liquid foam, it's isotropic and polydisperse. And okay, we have to understand better the physical mechanism underlying the complex acoustic density as for the liquid foams. And the results with liquid films encourage us to make the solid body and the membrane softer to conjugate the solid structure and the deformability of the liquid foams. And as a concluding sentence, I would say that thin films are the key features of the acoustic attenuation properties for liquid and solid membrane foams. So, thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Dr. Pierre, for this wonderful talk.